kind of background behind the scenes reasons for this project was Toiho, my students did some research in Rotorua and found that only 1 in 20 only 1 in 20 households in Rotorua had gardens, which is just crazy. We've got such big properties here. It's just a waste of space, a waste of resource. And vegetables are expensive to buy when you're on a tight budget. So if families can grow their own, if you grow it, you're more likely to eat it. And I see this, I work in early childhood centres and I see this all the time. If the children grow the food, they will want to eat it. Even if they hate carrots, if they grow the carrot, they will eat it. So part of this is about just developing that connection with our food. And if you have the connection with your food, you appreciate how much effort went into growing that carrot. And you're not just going to go, oh, yuck, a carrot and throw it away, because you know how many hours went into producing that food. So that's just part of it. The other thing is resilience. So if we were to be cut off by a natural disaster from our food source, which none of our food comes from here, it all gets trucked in on a daily basis. If we were to be cut off and we didn't have any food coming into Rotorua, we'd only, the supermarkets have 1 to 2 days worth of food in them, and we would need to depend on our gardens. So part of it was also about increasing our resilience as a community so that we can feed ourselves, and so that if something goes wrong, we've got this backup. We know how to grow food, and we've got food already growing. And then the third thing is just the connection with the earth. So Rosie Waller's a culinary tutor at Toho Mai, and she talks about how when her students come who are from overseas, they come and they don't have that much connection. But then when they get into the garden and they start growing some of the food that they're cooking, it really gives them a connection to this place. So part of it is about, for the people who live here, connecting to them to the earth, connecting them to this place, and connecting them to their food. So many aspects to this project, and it's ongoing. There's been talk of doing 100 gardens next year. I don't know if Te Arawa is up for that yet or not. We'll see. But it's something that we think will grow, and the more people that grow, the more people that talk about growing to other people, and you know, it has this kind of flow-on effect. So I will leave it there. I'm going to pass over to my partner in crime.
I do have one quick question for you. It's in relation to John Key's legislation about offending us with not being able to grow garden and backyard plants. Do you know anything about that and what the future is with that?
I heard some comments recently there was a concern when the Food Act first got brought in that we wouldn't be able to grow our own food and give it away or sell it. I'm not voting for National. That's probably my best comment.
I think just to help answer your question too, as Māori, we don't take too much notice of any new laws that are coming out.
Ko Te Arawa tāngata, ko Te Arawa waka mai maki tūki tōngā riro. Ko Ngāti Wenuku kōpako e tū atu nei, he iwi kōpaki I te Rotorua nui a kahu I kaurea nei e hine moa ki mokoia ki atu tānekai. Ko whakapau ngā kau te maunga, he ruri whenua ki tōku marae o rua matā. Ko kahutia paratome o taku pāpa, ko mere ape ape taku māma, no rongo mai wahine ki kahungunu. Ko te rangi kāheke a hau, no reira he mihi nāku ki a koutou I tēnei rangi, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou. It was John Rangihau who said that the answers to the following questions form the basis for us as Māori. Ko wai koe, no hea koe, ko wai o tūpuna, kei hea tō tūranga waiwai. And for my whānau at least, our tūranga waiwai o papakāinga was what we knew when we were growing up as kids as Rotokawa, Pikirangi, Whakapau Ngākau. It had all those names until recently a cousin of mine, Brant, said, hey, you're missing out Karamuramu. So Karamuramu is in there as well. But that was an idyllic spot on the eastern side of Lake Rotorua, where we all grew up, and the papakāinga was there. And if I'm looking towards Pikirangi Marae, on the left-hand side at the top of the road was one of our closest neighbours, and that was Bully and Matira Taikoto. And then over the other side of the road were the Ngāwhikas. And then on the opposite side to Bully and Matira was Sam Hodge and Alice Hodge. And then us down by the lake. At least those were the names that were familiar to us. Although, as I said, many years later, Barnes said to me, hey, you're missing Karamuramu. But it was there on those shores where my father had a 2-acre marakai, and he grew continuously all year round. And he lived by the Maramataka. And another landmark, of course, is Mokoia Island, because my dad was born on Mokoia. And he was raised tending to their marakai and especially to their kumara plantations and their ruakumara. And so some context and some background for you. It could also be said that all this is the genesis to the interest and passion I have for marakai. So perhaps a good way to start this presentation.
We are stardust, we are golden, and we got to get ourselves back to the God.
We are stardust, we are golden, we are billion-year carbon. And we've got to get ourselves back to the garden. And it was what Joni Mitchell penned back in the day when she wrote the song around this, and how true that kōrero is. So, when you think about it, you know, when you think about the whakapapa narrative, our tūpuna echoed all that millennia ago and continue to do it today, you cannot help but conclude that we are all billion-year carbon. We come from the same whakapapa as these plants. The plants are us and we are the plants. The seeds are us and we are the seeds. And one of the things that I've been told is if when planting your seed, one of the first things that we should be doing is we should be making that real close connection to the seed. Connecting our DNA to the seed. And the seed returns its DNA to you. And I've had pumpkin and I've had pumpkin. And I've had kamukamo and I've had kamukamo. And the ones that have returned to me are the ones where you connect the DNA. You know, we don't have our puna at Pikirangi anymore, and we had it for years, until some pōko kuhua went and put a bulldozer over it and built an airport there. But that was, you know, the taonga that the old people had passed on to us. And even though they put an airport there, each year we would still go across the tarmac and pick our watercress that our mother had planted in that puna. we'd have our bags and away we'd go, you know, and we'd be expecting all these red lights to come roaring down. No one ever came. But they had all their, I was told years later that they had their cameras on us. And then, of course, you know, in 2012, after they blow up all the towers, they go and then put security fences all the way around the airports, right throughout the world. And of course, that destroyed completely the puna and the watercress. Now, blackberry was prolific. My dad was a First World War, and somehow he managed to talk this beautiful English bride to marrying him over there. And she said to him at one point, hey, when you're not fighting wars, what do you do back in New Zealand? He said, I'm a berry farmer. And she said, oh man, a berry farmer, yeah. I'll jump onto this flash bugger. Well, he brought her to Pikirangi. And all the way down that path, all the way down that road, right down to the lake, was blackberry on both sides. But I have to tell you, it was the sweetest blackberry. Hey, mate. It was the sweetest blackberry. And so, you know, there was kai all around the place. Now, this one here, oh, shit. You know, trying to get this out of the ground, eh? This is, yeah, bracken, or aruhe. And would you believe it, the old people ate this, eh? This was all part of their staple diet. And this, those roots there at the bottom there, that's what we had to dig out when we were kids. You know, and these things used to go 3 or 4 metres high, these bracken, eh? Well, you can imagine me, you know, I would have only been about, and looking up at these things with my father saying, go on, boy, dig that bloody thing, dig that soil out, eh? And, you know, trying to get all this. Anyway, that's another story. Now, this isn't the puha that we used to get down at Pikirangi. This is just a really nice one that I found on the website. But but you have to say mean, eh? You know, that's the top line of the puha. That's the choi choi of the puha, eh? It's the mean puha. You know, I was looking at that boil up there and I said, oh no, that's not choi choi. Anyway, harakeke just grew all over the place. Prolific. And then these bloody bulldozers came along, right? And changed it all, changed the landscape. You're going to hear a lot of the word anyway. So, pickle pickle, I heard about Nonga Taha Dee, look, there's no more at Pikirangi anymore, is there? No. There's no more at Pikirangi anymore. So, Nonga Taha is the place that I'll be visiting. And and I'll come and see your brother later on, have a cordial, have a catch up. Oh, now, Horopito didn't grow there. But when Branch and I were putting this together, she said, Cuz, throw that one in, it's a really neat looking photo. So Horopito is there. Huh? Well, Riwai, yes. Riwai was always, it was, well, you know, my dad grew Riwai, Kumara, pumpkin, watermelon even, you know, and grew it tremendously well. Nothing to be said about kamukamo, eh? You know, that's just par for the course. Well, kawakawa, and I've heard it already about the narrative around kawakawa, eh? What a dynamic plant that is. You know, I was sitting at the table there and I was looking at my other cousin back there, down the back there, Hariata, and she's eating this kauda. And I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, where the hell did she get that from? Not said a word until she nearly finished. She said, did you get any coda? You know? Well, kāngapito. My dad knew how to do his kāngapito. And to such an extent that he knew the environment. He had an intimate, not relationship, but knowledge base of the environment. And that was all because of the Maramataka. They knew that lake well. They knew where all the kauta were. When we used to go out for a rummy every night, within a half an hour we would have our tub full of kauta. What's that mean? Sorry. Oh, look, yeah, they're absolutely right. Hang on, you're stealing my thunder. Steal my thunder. Gee, this is my show, shut up. So he knew the environment so well, and where he used to place the kānga was really important because it was almost like a ledge that went out from the from the bank all the way out, and was a rock ledge that went out and it turned into a bit of a J. And he would go out there into that part where it turned into a J, and that was where he put his corn. And yes. Absolutely. And it was such that it helped to keep the predators, base land predators, away from it. And then what he had to consider were, and that's including kids too, by the way. And then what had to be considered was that the underwater predators that could get at the bags. So the flow of the water had to be such, hey, so that the fish would go along, try and get in, and they'd, away they'd go again. And so that was the intimate knowledge that those people had of their environment. And that all tied in with the Maramataka. I don't know how they ate these things, but they did, eh? And that was one thing that I never took to, was the okākahi. We only ever knew them as cockabullies, eh?
Cockabullies?
Yeah. You remember that, cuz? Yeah.
Sorry.
It's all right. Did your mother ever eat them hariata?
No,
no. What
about
this? Buddy did? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, my father and them did, eh? They're like eating evils, didn't he? They had cast iron gut, eh, a lot of our people? They did. They had cast iron gut. You know, my father used to put that bloomin' sheep, what do they call that? No, you know, you cut a sheep up and mutton flaps. And they used to stick them in the fridge and leave them in there forever and a day, and then they'd pull them out and they'd undo the newspaper and it was all green, you know? And all they do is just wipe it all off, put it in the pot and boil it up, and away they'd go. It was kaitan. Anyway. I want to talk about for a moment kumara. And before I do that, I want to acknowledge my comrade, my colleague, and my very good friend Bernie Hornfeck. Bernie is 89 years old, and he gets around in his new electric car, because you know the truck that you saw on there?
Yeah.
It went up in smoke, eh? He burnt it. His whole whare burnt down. And was in the whare and it burned down and it all went up in flames. So now he's got this flash electric car that we get around in. But I want to acknowledge you, Mātua, because you've been a diehard for Maara Kai in Te Arawa here for a long, long, long time. And it's been through you and my connection to you that the interest for Maara Kai has been revitalised and been reborn. And in fact, Mātua was born in 1928, and my father was on his second wife by then. Because in fact, my father had three wives. And he had 31 kids from those three wives. His own little dynasty, you know. And so it was important that he grew kumara. And, And so we have been growing kumara here for a number of years now, Bernie and I, and we've decided on what we're calling a step change. We need to step it up. Otherwise, we're going to be doing what we've always done, and we'll always get what we've always got. Yeah. So we are now about ready to go on a hīkoi north, on a kumara hīkoi north. There's 12 of us going away at the end of this month for 5 days, and we're going to go up and have a look at how they do it up the north. Nothing wrong with that. But our step change has come about, or the need for a step change has come about, because we have some gaps in our knowledge base. And it's around all of this: propagation, preservation, disease, prevention, storage, varieties, plant and machinery, production per hectare, packing sheds, planting methods, growing tipu, fertilizers, even the latest science, sharing stories. That's even before we understand the whakapapa, the karakia, the mōteatea, the rua kumara. So we've got a big learning curve that we're on. And so we're taking this, we're away on our hīkoi. Jasmin and I and a few others at Healthy Families are involved with an organisation called Kai Rotorua, and we're proposing to have a food hub, which is for, this thing grows by the minute, this proposed food hub, four 40-foot shipping containers. One's going to have a seed bank in it. One will have a gardening tool bank. One will have a seed bank cafe. And a kumara bank. An interactive miniature museum is what we're marketing this as. Telling the arrival of the kumara to Rotorua with a historical photographic film and video platform to a contemporary overview of what we're doing today. And we're also looking, and we brought a Japanese lady on board with us, because Japanese know about kumara as well, eh? And typically Japanese, they produce a whole lot of stuff that we don't even get anywhere near at the moment. So we want to bring that on board with us. And that will include kumara produce, kumara byproducts, including sweets, cakes, desserts, cosmetics, ice cream. Well, I like this one here, the sake bit. Balms, homemade preserves, homemade fresh, homegrown fresh vegetable gardens, and administration hub. Now, we've just been given a 1 acre block. Not going to tell you fellas where it is. With the option of another. And this season, what we're going to do is we're going to plant half of the 1 acre in Riwe, and the other half we're going to plant and trial kumara. And on our hīkoi north, we've already arranged to bring 7 variety of kumara back, the tipu, and plant them up here to see exactly what takes here in Rotorua. So we're talking about a step change here, about having to, and we do have to step up, particularly if we want to start selling this as an income stream for to keep our hub going. And we need to step up, and we need to get our head around a lot of the regulations around kai, around food, and so that's all going to be part of this learning curve. You see those words under there, off the grid model. And so we have a person by the name of Brendan O'Connor, who is experienced with, he's a design architect and he's a design engineer. And we brought him on board and we said, we've got no money to pay you, so you've got to do this for volunteers. He said, yeah, that's me. And he's had years of experience in designing shipping containers over in Australia. And he's got all the software in the world. And I said, yeah, you've got to bring a clever pākehā on board at times, eh? You know, that's how you move this wheelbarrow forward sometimes. Anyway, he's going to design it for it, and he's doing it as we speak. And the real cool thing about it And I said to Brendan, I'm coming to this hui today and I'm going to tell him about you, a bit about you. He has multiple sclerosis and he's in a wheelchair. A sharp brain with a body that's deteriorating. But how really pleased that we went to him to have the kōrero and to get this up and running and bring him in and connect him to it. He's just over the moon with it, you know. He's not sitting at home with his parents anymore. Now, what's next? Those are the days we go on our hikoi. We visit Māngere Mountain, Te Pane o Matoho, because they grow mean kumara there, and we want to try and get that whakaro and some of that knowledge. Te Mahurehure Marae at Point Chev, North Teke Tai Tokerau, Wānanga at Whangarei, and they're putting on a big what to do for us when we arrive there. Te Hauhanga Aorongo Marae in Dargaville. Then we're going to be Wānanga around the science of the kumara. And the kumara box itself is a commercial grower up in Dargaville. And we're going to go and have a look at his operation. We need to have a look at anything and everything around kumara. We're going to go and visit Tane Mahuta on the way to the Kuanga Institute at Hokianga. Now, in Auckland, at the Wynyard Quarter at the Auckland waterfront, they've built what they call a flagship centre, and it's an education centre for sustainable coastlines around New Zealand. It's quite a big complex. And so they've invited us to go there because it's been built out of shipping containers. So we want to go and have a look at that as well. Elise Puketapu and Nick, another connection that we've just made is with the Tahuri Whenua. Anybody aware of that group, that organisation? Yep, ka pai matua. Good stuff?
Yeah. And their publications are really good. Mean.
And so we're going to be linking up with them and they will help us with kumara as well. Here's some of the stuff we've been doing. This is in Noataha, in the backyard in Noataha, on Wikaraka Street. We are stars.